This series is about the disappearance of something, religious faith. It's the story of what is often referred to as atheism, the history of the growing conviction that God doesn't exist. Given the fact that so many recent history programs have all the resources of dramatic reconstruction, not to mention computer-generated animations, I should perhaps warn you that what you're not going to see in this program is anything that you might be tempted to think of as walking with atheists. I will not be seen leaning over a balcony like this, watching René Descartes nibbling his quill while he struggles with the problem of mind-brain duality. And there will be no blurred, slow-motion shots of people making leaps of faith or failing to do so. Well, first of all, because I think such dramatizations are somewhat vulgar and they're inappropriate.
Gaze into this crystal and you will behold a few of them.
And in any case, I think such an approach supposes that from the vantage point of a time machine, I'd be able to look down fondly upon individuals who are clearly antecedents of people like myself, who had to go through the penalties, dangers, and risks of atheism, whilst I could luxuriate in the achievements which they won unknowingly on my behalf. No, in looking backwards, we will not find people who are the counterparts of those of us today who enjoy the luxury of thoughtless disbelief. All the same, while these programs may reveal how the doctrines and dogmas of religious faith have been called into question, I suppose that the doctrines and dogmas of modern television require me to present you with a trailer of what you have in store.
Is God willing to prevent evil, but not able? Then he is not omnipotent. Is he able, but not willing? Then he is malevolent.
In making this series, I've inevitably discovered that the history of faith and doubt is a great deal more complicated than it might seem.
Is God both able and willing? Then whence cometh evil? Is he neither able nor willing? Then why call him God?
My inquiry has been helped by conversations I've had with historians, writers, scientists, and philosophers.
I think most people who say they believe in God, most people in the West who say they believe in God, actually believe in belief in God.
Well, I tried to be a religious person when I was 12, 13, 14. It lasted about 2 years.
People are so used to the idea that complicated things in our human world are indeed designed and made. But when you've said, oh, it was designed by God, you've explained absolutely nothing.
A week maybe, or a few days after the September 11 disaster, there was a huge service here in New York City, and I watched it on television, and people were singing, "The Lord is my shepherd." And a friend was watching the same program on television, told me, "Wow, some shepherd."
It's some years since I was on the Staten Island ferry, and when I last looked back at it from here, the skyline was dominated by the twin towers of the World Trade Center. It seems quite odd to think of it in the light of religion, but its absence now reminds me of the religious implications of what one saw on television on that hideous day. And although when it happened, many people said it was a cowardly act, atrocious it certainly was, it really is quite hard to see it as cowardly exactly, since it was perpetrated by people who sacrifice themselves in the certain knowledge of their forthcoming death. It's inconceivable that it could have been done without religion. For it's only in the name of some sort of absolute assurance of a permanent life after death that someone would be willing to undertake such an act. And we know that the men who did so did it in the name of a religion which they upheld against a society whose lack of religion, as they saw it, they deplored, and whose support of Jewish claims in what is called the Holy Land they were implacably opposed to. Therefore, the conspicuous absence of the Twin Towers, involving as it does the inherent conflicts between Christianity, Islam, and Judaism, is, I think, one of the most powerful expressions of religious fanaticism in the late 20th and early 21st centuries. Understandably, for Americans, the events of September the 11th aroused tremendous feelings of hostility towards the religion in whose name the terrorist act had apparently been performed. It drew attention to the difference between them, the Americans on the one hand, and the Muslim world. But it's important to remember that you only have to travel a few miles from New York City to find yourself in the middle of a country which, far from being the secular world, which was deplored and attacked by the Islamic fundamentalists, is in fact intensely Christian, and therefore, in its own way, of course, just as religious as the Muslim world that attacked it. But for someone like myself, who has nothing that you could possibly call a religious belief or even feeling, the spectacle of September the 11th is a forceful reminder of the potentially destructive power of the three great monotheistic religions that have dominated the world in one way or another for nearly 2,000 years. I wouldn't want to say, and I think it would be entirely inaccurate to say, that my interest in or my objections to these religions was actually provoked by the events of the last 2 years. All the same, these events do bring one face to face with the consequences, both social and political, of beliefs in the divine, the supernatural, the holy, the sacred, and the transcendent. Ideas which I, like many others, find alien, uncongenial, and to be frank, almost unintelligible.
Because I don't think there's enough evidence to prove. If there was such a guy up there, so they say, in the sky, whatever, wherever he is in heavens above, then why is there so much? There's people starving all over the world. There's wars. There's everything. Why would he stand by and let that happen?
I've never believed in God. Sent to Sunday school as a child, but that was to me just to be got out of the way.
I partly won't believe, yes, until I had a 3-year-old granddaughter die. Now, why should God believe, take a child away from the family? 3 years and 8 months. Why? I'm sorry. I don't believe.
I was actually brought up to believe in God, but I don't believe in him. I've found my own ways now.
I've undertaken this series partly because I want to investigate the antecedents, if you like, of my own disbelief, and to consider the history of what I'm reluctant to call atheism. In fact, I'm rather reluctant to call myself an atheist. And that's not because I'm embarrassed or ashamed of it, or because I fear for my life, as I might have done in the olden days if I'd announced that I was. Nor have I any reason to think that I might be socially disabled in a way that I once might have been. No. The reason I'm so reluctant is that atheism itself has acquired almost sectarian connotations, And it hardly, as far as I can see, seems worthwhile having a name for something which scarcely enters my thoughts at all. For myself, as for many people, it's only in the light of such current controversies with regard to belief that I've found myself willing to explicitly articulate my disbelief. I think it's important to make a series like this because at a moment when intense commitments to different forms of monotheistic religion have now acquired, or rather reacquired, such an intense political connotation, it's important to indicate that the widespread suspicion of disbelief is becoming a real threat to free thought. It isn't as if atheism were a small religious sect. In fact, it's not another form of religious belief at all. And it's important to understand that disbelievers constitute a much larger percentage of the population than religious people, and especially politically motivated religious people, would like to think.
I haven't believed in Christianity. I haven't believed in any religious doctrine for... well, since I was 17 or 18.
I never really believed it, and I always thought that all of the religious services at school were ludicrous. Loved the hymns, but the content of the hymns were so absurd. Dense theology, weird stuff.
I am one God, and if you don't worship me, you will burn forever. I always thought that was ugly.
They felt that science would be a corrosive to religious belief, and they were worried about it. Damn it, I think they were right. It is corrosive of religious belief. And it's a good thing, too.
I remember sort of trying hard to keep up with it, going to some sort of religious meeting, and I just was sitting and listening, and I thought, this is a load of rubbish. I just don't think this is true anymore.
I was born in England, but my grandparents came here from Lithuania as Jewish refugees. And for Jews, spread as they are across the world, their religion has always seemed an essential part of their cultural identity.
Well, this is the first time in almost 60 years that I've visited a place of worship for anything other than sightseeing. And when I first came here, it was in the name of religion, though not with any religious motive on my part. The fact is, I was sent here by a Jewish father, sent here because he thought that I owed it to what he called my people. And the reason is that quite suddenly, because he had been so appalled about what had happened in the Holocaust and guilty about having escaped it, that he felt that he and I owed some sort of identification with the group. Throughout the war from 1940, at which time I was six, until 1945 or 46, I don't really think that I knew or really understood that I was Jewish. When my father said that I was, I didn't really know what he meant. I came here to several services when I was about 11 or 12 on what were called the high holidays. But I came here without knowing what I was participating in. It was conducted in a foreign language which I didn't understand, written in text I couldn't even read. There was singing. But the singing was completely different to the singing with which I had grown much more familiar by virtue of the fact that I was a prep school boy and attended Christian prayers.